Hi friends, good day. Today I'm starting a new topic called as department accounts, departmental accounts. So what is the meaning of departmental accounts? When a business is generally split up into a number of departments, when it sells different types of goods or carries on several activities under the same roof, each department is treated as a separate profit center. See, a business is generally split up into number of departments when it sells different types of goods or carries on several activities under the same roof. And each such department is treated as a separate profit center. It means, like, you see, the best example I can give you. Nowadays we are seeing malls, various malls, shopping malls, where you are having 3 to 4 floors. Ground floor is for catering needs of the particular set of customers. First floor is for particular set of customers. Like different floors. Now we are having jewelry, clothes, everything at one particular place. Like kids related, men related, women related, or we can say ornament, gold, jewelry, whatever you are having under one same roof, single roof. It is called as departmental account. Now, if you look at it, they are going to treat each particular segment, each particular floor as a separate profit center. And they wish to know the activities of that, and what are the purchases that they have made, and what is the result of that particular activity? Is it viable for them to continue that particular department, particular block or not? Okay, you can take an example of a Charma's showroom. Charma's showroom, even you are having footwear section also now. Footwear section, everything. Like Reliance Digital, you can say Reliance Mart or Reliance Stores. You got ground floor is for like clothes, and first floor is like for digital electronics, like depending upon the space which they are having. DMart is a recent, the business which is fast growing one, and which has attracted lot of customers. They are able to capture the market of a big bazaar. Once upon a big bazaar was a dominating one, you know. Just simply I'm telling, this is my personal opinion. I don't know really, if you, unless you look at the data, you can't say which is dominating, but it's very clearly evident. You can see DMart is there in everywhere now. Okay, so the Reliance is also competition, like Bajaj Electronics, you can see TV segment, and is one particular floor. Refrigerators at one particular, air conditions, depending upon. So each wing, each block, each floor, they want to treat as a separate profit center. So that is the main purpose of, I think this is basically like a final account chapter. I told you, department account, branch accounts is more of ascertainment of result. So that is what has been mentioned here also. And one more thing, let me give you, then we can refer to the notes which is displayed on the screen from our study material. Department is a particular concern, may be classified according to their function. Example, purchasing department, selling department, finance department, production department, subsidiary service like transport, packing, repairs, etc. And also you can see that the best example you can give, even the Maruti car showroom or Santro or whatever you talk about. Now there you are also having different departments, like you purchase a vehicle, accessories, you got one department, maintenance, servicing, another department. I think these are the things which you can give, depending upon the type of activities which you carry. Okay, like we are having problems cloth, stitching, and ready-made garments. Cloth department will buy it, and you are transferring to stitching department, tailoring department. After making it, they will be transferring to the ready-made garment store. I think different departments like that. Certain things which are visible to us, certain things which are not visible. I think they are having their own calculation of, they got their own mechanism of calculating the results. So why you should go for the such classification? Why can't we take as a overall picture? Yeah, overall picture is ultimately the result which as a business unit, entire, whatever your different floors you are having, see, Chandana Grand or RK, what is that called, so many RS Brothers, so many things we are seeing nowadays. So these things, they want to, as a one single business enterprise, they want to get the result. But if you go for the department wise, segment wise, the asset treatment or result, I think they can focus more. If it is not viable because of the particular department, there is a dent in profit, I think why should I continue that? I can expand the same which is profitable. I can have one more floor the same with same thing. Okay, I'll let me give an example where in my locality, near my locality where I stay, one particular, I don't want to name that particular, even if I know, if I name also doesn't affect you on record. There's a one restaurant called Chutneys. They have started taking three floors building for carrying of their activity, pure vegetarian hotel. So the ground floor was empty. So I think they already two floors, very big halls they got. I think that's enough for doing the business. Weekend generally you got a lot of demand for that in the nearby our locality. It is not exactly said like Kukatpally or Amirpet or Panjagutta, something like that. So what I have noticed that they have started with a sweet shop. They have invested quite a bit furniture, well furnished and with quality sweets. But I think that particular locality, very few people can go. The location you talk about in economics. So they started. Then finally, after 6 months or after 1 year, they went for good advertisement. People, they are just used to look at it. And these are perishable nature sweets. You can't just continue like that, no? They maintained quality, and finally after 6 months or after 1 year, I don't remember exactly, they've taken out that. The reason is that it is not profitable. Why should they waste time and manpower and department, again, cook appointing cook for making the sweets and people appointing them to sell? I think then finally they said, okay, let us have like empty space. Even if there's any rush, during the rush, they want, they can add some additional chairs, something like that. See, this is my observation. Just I'm telling you. I think this is what the main reason why you want to know the department-wise results. So if you want to know department-wise results, you also need to have a proper system of accounting, you know, proper system of accounting. So that there it comes, we talk about methods of departmental accounting. To know that why should you want to go for this, I've already explained. Even we can see here, before I go to the methods of department account, whatever has been mentioned here on this screen, it is there in the study material. When all divisions of a business are located under one roof and it is desired to ascertain the profit or loss of each department or class of goods separately, then departmental accounts are prepared. The main objects of preparing such accounts are to have a comparison of results of a particular department with previous year and also with other department of same concern. The department-wise result, you can compare with the current year department result with the previous, same, during same period, what was my result? And also one department with other department. And we'll be coming, when we work out problems, we'll also be having the significance of attached to is that calculation of managerial remuneration, etc. I think these things are really important. Then to help the owners formulating policy to expand the business on proper lines so as to optimize the profits of the concern, right? And if result is encouraging, as I told you, they can go for optimization of going for expansion of the business. And to allow department manager commission on the basis of this, I have told you already, we are having very important point, third one, we are having some problems on this. To allow department of managers commission on the basis of the profit of their department, it is a kind of a motivation. So if you combined everything as one particular unit, then what happened? You don't know which department is doing really well, and who is really working hard, which manager is working hard. So department-wise commission, if you go along with the regular salary also, then you will be knowing the performance. It motivates the particular department manager to go for expansion of sales and maximization of profits so that he can get more commission on that. I think this is the idea, reason behind this. Department in a particular concern may be classified according to functions like purchasing department, selling department, finance department, production department, subsidy service. Purchasing department, they will be only looking at purchasing. But sir, purchasing department, how you can get results, sir? Purchasing department will be transferring goods to selling department. So while they are transferring, purchasing departments transferring to selling department, if it is at cost, no significance. Purchasing department, they are purchasing for 100 rupees, they are transferring to selling department at 120 rupees. Then that particular department may be getting profit. Or sometimes selling department may not be getting everything from the purchasing department. Sometimes they need to go and buy from the outsiders also. Got it? Like you talk about accessories, I talk about the vehicle accessories. Sometimes the purchasing department, which they provide, the accessories they are giving to selling department. But sometimes the accessories are not available. They need to buy from outside sometimes. The customer is asking a particular brand, a particular thing. I think that is not available from purchasing department. Then they need to buy. So I think these all are the things. We can't say exactly unless you are into really the functional area or real-time situation. You can't know how it is significant, how it is affecting. Just for theoretical sake, we are discussing today. Selling department, financing department, production department, subsidy service like transport, packing. This is depending upon the activities of an organization. The management may decide to go for department-wise analysis. Department accounts are generally employed in large business. This is important. In large business, such as large general stores, I told you, big bazaar and big basket also we are seeing nowadays. Insurance companies, and these all are things they will be using. In order to ascertain the gross profit earned by different departments, departmental trading account is prepared in a columnar form. Like, you know, trading account you prepare. But what we will be doing, we will be going X department, Y department, Z department. Instead of preparing X department gross profit separately, Y department gross profit separately, we'll be having tabular or columnar form of calculating departmental wise profit. There is no difficulty in ascertaining the figures of opening stock, closing stock, purchases, sales and direct expense because you will be provided with information of department wise. But the problem is that, the reason is that why it is not difficult, because columnar form of books for stocks, purchases, sales returns and direct expense can be maintained. But the problem is with indirect expenses, or we can say common expenses. Indirect expenses which are nothing but common expenses. For the concern as whole and may be relating to sales, distribution, finance, until these are distributed among the department on suitable basis. The reason is that if you common expense, how to allocate common expenses is an issue here. If you can able to allocate common expenses among the various departments that we'll be discussing today, then the ascertainment of result will be easy. Okay. There are few more points which is not there. Just let me, for your reference, just I want to wish to take out this. So, methods of departmental accounts, where separate set of books are maintained for each department. It is independent department. So, what I'll be telling you that to have some clarity of thought on this. Methods of departmental accounts. Just for information I am giving you, we don't have any problems on this. Just to have a clarity of thought, methods of departmental accounts. Trying to explain you. Here, where separate set of books are maintained. Where separate set of books are maintained. Okay. Maintain for each department. This is called as independent department. Independent department means their purchases are different. You don't have this X department is not depending on Y, Y department is not depending on X. Such independent department, they are having their own purchases. They can't get any transfer from other department. They can't transfer to other department also. They buy, they sell. This is called as independent. When in such case, separate set of books are maintained. This is very simple. Because you got the data of X department separately, Y, then this, it is as good as final accounts. No need for you to learn. It doesn't have much significance. Generally, this method is being followed in very large organization or where the maintenance of separate books is compulsory as per some law of the land. So, I told you generally this method is being followed by very large organization or where the maintenance of separate books is compulsory as per some law of the land. Example, general insurance company in India have to maintain separate accounts for each type like their business like fire, marine insurance, accidental insurance. You are having general insurance company, you are having different department wise, different departments, fire related activities, fire insurance, marine insurance, accidental insurance. So, in this case, you need to, this is called as independent department. So obviously they will be maintaining separate set of books. Even it is being required as per act also. Okay. So here I can give example of general insurance company. Have to maintain separate set of accounts for each type of business. Each type of business. Example, fire comma marine insurance, etc. Okay, this is as per statute. Generally they are maintained. This when separate set of books are maintained. Now, but here the disadvantage of this method is costly and rarely used. But why these general insurance as per statute? I told you they are maintaining as per statute. As per statute, they are maintaining this. Otherwise, this method is not required to be followed. But generally, this is a bit expensive. But for this, as per statute and the nature of activities also different. No, that is the reason why they will be going for this. So the first point is I have explained when separate set of books are maintained. Let me explain the B part of it. Where accounts of all departments are maintained together. Together in columnar way. In columnar way. So that they know department wise profits department wise profit they know departmental wise profits, so that generally they will be maintaining or preparing this method. That means when separate set of books are not maintained, that means they will be, see this, I told you first point, even separate set of books are maintained. Here, as I told you, in this case, separate set of books are not maintained. Where accounts of all departments are maintained together. What do you mean by way to show that they know department-wise result, profits, or you can put it profit or loss. Nothing but that is nothing but result, no? So what is the meaning of that is no separate set of books are maintained. Okay, so how they prepare? So note, generally they prepared departmental trading, comma, profit and loss account. I told you for result. And also most important, this is important, and also to know the result of a business as a whole, entire business, X department, Y department, Z department. If you combine the total result, for that also they prepare and also should, and to know the result of a business as a whole, they prepare an account called as general P&L account. Which account they prepare? General P&L account. Okay, I think this is simple. So two things we have learned, the meaning we have learned, advantages we have learned. The method of department accounts have learned. Now, the most important discussion of today's class is basis for allocation of common expenditure. Basis for allocation of common expenditure among different departments. I don't want to waste your time by just simply writing here, or what I do, I wish to take you to that particular our study material, ICS study material. There they clearly mentioned. And here, what we have learned, department PDF here, we have seen. See, this finance and all these are distributed among the departments on suitable basis. Common indirect expenses, which are common for the concern as a whole and may be relating to sales distribution on some suitable basis. This is what I have written here. Allocation. On different departments on some suitable basis. Which are as follows. Let us refer to this. Allocation of expenses. This is what has been mentioned. Common expenses, the benefit of which is shared by all departments and which are capable of precise allocation or distribute among department concerned on some equitable basis, considered suitable in the circumstance of case. That we will be discussing 12.4, 12.5 page. Allocation of expenses. The common expenses, like say, let me explain this. I need not write anything on this. It's already there on the screen. Rent, rates and taxes, repairs. And maintenance, insurance of building. The rent you can't have department wise. Okay, good. If you can have, when you take the business is taking the property, the particular building premises on a lease. Excuse me, on a lease, they will be having a common, like they say, the entire building, they will be calculating the rent. Similarly, any taxes, municipal taxes or whatever, will be local taxes, any repairs which is attached to building or maintenance, and also you have to take insurance policy for protecting the building against fire accident or anything like that. How you have to allocate floor area occupied by each department if given, otherwise on time basis. Please remember, floor area, we generally we talk about plinth area in terms of SFT, 1000 SFT plinth area. Like we got CHAMS, ground floor, first floor, second floor, or first floor, second. First floor, what is the area that has been occupied? First floor, what is second floor, what is the floor area that has been occupied? Parking area, like depending upon the floor area occupied by each department given, otherwise on time basis. Time basis, you just keep on allocating. So please try to understand, floor area occupied by each department if given, floor area, otherwise on time basis, how many months you have used, like that. The time basis we have seen, like profit or loss prior to incorporation. And I remember when once a question came in the examination about write a few lines about allocation of expenses. I've seen students writing profit or loss prior to incorporation. It confusing a bit. So please be watchful, be careful. You already had that chapter, you have already learned about it. So be watchful about it. So expenses look same, time basis, turnover, that is completely different. But this is completely different. This is year-wise common expenses, how you are going to allocate. Okay, rent, rates, taxes, etc., floor area occupied. Lighting and heating, that is energy expenses, consumption of energy by each department, that units has to be given. Selling expenses, that is discount, bad debts, selling commission, freight. I think if you remember, even in profit or loss prior to incorporation also, it was on the basis of turnover, you know, the same thing. Variable expense we talk about, same. Sales of each department. Carriage inward, discount received, purchase of each department, because these all are related to purchase of goods. Wages, salaries, time devoted to each department. Depreciation, insurance, repairs, maintenance of capital assets. Value of assets of each department, otherwise on time basis. Administrative and other expenses. Example, salaries of managers, directors, common, advertisement expenses, etc. They all comes under the basis of time basis or equally. Okay, depreciation is on the basis of value of each department. Wages and salary, time devoted. Administrative and other expenses, time basis are equally among all departments. Labor welfare expenses, number of employees in each department. Provident fund, ESI, employee state insurance, contributors, whatever it may be, wages and salaries of each department. So there are certain expenses in income, most being of financial nature, which cannot be proportioned on a suitable basis. Therefore, they are recognized in the combined P&L account, or it is called as popularly general P&L account. Both are same, my dear friends. In the study material, they are using the term combined P&L account, but in other books, they will be using the term general P&L account. No problem. Meaning is same. You can note down this combined P&L account, or you can also call it general P&L account. For example, interest on loan, profit or loss on sale of investment, etc. How to allocate? The expenses are income which you cannot allocate. The expenses are income which you cannot allocate can be taken as a general P&L account expenses. Clear to all of you? The expenses which you cannot allocate is to be treated as expenses pertaining to general P&L account, or maybe income also. So this all told, I have all told you types of department, independent department, dependent. Dependent departments means when you transfer goods from one department to other department, it is dependent. Independent department means they are having negligible interdepartment or no transfer. Generally, they carry out their activity separately. Such are called as independent departments. Okay, let me come back to this again. Continue. So this I told you to refer back to page number. Here you can make a note. 12.4 and 12.5. Okay, here I am writing. Got this in study material. From this you can copy. So now the most important thing, this is very important point, this class we are discussing interdepartmental transfer. So first we are discussing today interdepartmental transfer. Okay. When transfer is there from one department to another department, how the transfers can be made? Here I am writing. Transfer from one department to another department either at cost price or cost price plus agreed percentage of profit. It can be on cost price or market price, you know the word, or it can be at market. I think three possibilities. Transfer from one department is either at cost price or cost price plus agreed percentage of profit, or third one is market. See it, all of you. Cost price, let me. Or market price. Generally, we will be having two things on. Generally, in the examination, generally we will be having cost price plus agreed percentage of profit. This is what. Or market price means including percentage of profit. Generally, we will be having problems on this basis. Interdepartment transfer. If it is at cost price, the problem is very simple. So now, if you take an example, suppose A transferred transfer goods to department B. Now, for department A, it is treated as good as sale. For department B, it is treated as good as purchase. Clear? This is interdepartmental transfer. For one department, department A, it is as good as sale. Here, department B, it is treated as good as purchases. But what happened then? The situation where when A is depart transferring, when you are treating as a sale, A sells a 10 rupees item at percentage of profit of 12 rupees, then at the time of sale, A is treating this 12 rupees has been sold. Okay, so what I want, before I take you to the next point, let me tell you, 10 units, cost price 10 rupees, 10 into 10, 100. This is purchase for whom? A. Initially they purchased. A has purchased these 10 units. Cost price 10 rupees. So that is totally 10 into 10 coming to 100. And these units have been sold. Purchase of A. Sold to B. 10 into 12. 120. What is profit you are having? 20 rupees. Okay. Do you get all of you? Now let me take, suppose the same thing will become for department B. This is example of purchases by A. Transfer to B is as good as sales, no? Transfer to B. Transfer to B. Now what is profit? 20. Now let me tell you, department B transfer from A. It becomes 120 for no, because selling price of A is nothing but purchase price of B. So they are transferring to B at 120. Same thing becomes, it is transfer from A, as I told you, as good as purchase, no? For department B, it becomes cost. Then what happened? How many units they have received? 10. 10 units. What is cost price? 120. Now department B sold 8 items at the rate of say 14 rupees. 8 items at the rate of 14 rupees. So 8 into 14, it is coming to how much? 112 rupees. What is unsold? 2 units. 2 units, and what is the cost price for them? It's 12 rupees. No, 2 into 12, 20. This sold. This is unsold. So 112 plus 24. It is coming to how much? 136. Here it is 136. Come on, tell me the profit for them. 16. How, sir? Simple. 12 rupees item. The rate of 12 rupees, no? 12 rupees item, they are selling it for 2 rupees, no? 14 rupees, no? 2 rupees profit, no? How many items they have sold? 8 items or 8 units. Correct. Now, let us see. Can you tell me, realistically, what is the profit? Giving time. What is the overall profit? You don't need any commerce background for this. Science students without any commerce background, they can answer it very quickly. I'm giving 1 minute time before I tell you what is the overall business profit. I'm not talking about department A profit, department B profit. If department A profit, if you feel like 20 rupees department A profit, sir, department B profit is 16, total profit is 36. You think of it, total profit is 36. If you go by the analysis, if you go by this, right or wrong? This is what, like, you, this I just explained. This you can prepare like a trading account, debit side, this is credit side. My answer is 32. Do you agree with me or not? My answer is 32, my dear friends. This is department A has transferred to B. B has sold. A and B department belongs to AB Enterprises now, for example. AB Enterprises is one single unit. In that A department profit B. But A has purchased that transfer to B because here, in this case, B is depending on A department. We are having the problems based on dependent departments only. And no separate set of books are maintained. That means common expenses are recorded except columnar wise register for purchases, sale they maintain, stock they maintain, but expenses, for that expenses they are not going for department wise allocation. If they go for department wise allocation of expenses, then this topic doesn't have any significance. It is as good as any normal final account chapter. It's very simple. See, total 10 units purchased, 10 units has been transferred to B. B has sold 8. What is selling price of 8, my dear friend? 14 rupees. What is overall cost price to business AB Enterprise as a whole? 10 rupees. 14 minus 10, 4 rupees, no? 4 rupees into 8 units, 32 rupees. The actual profit has to be how much? 32 rupees. If you prepare, this you will be knowing through an account called as general, or I told you, combined P&L account. That credit side you are writing this. So now you need to get a profit of 32 rupees. Sir, why we are getting difference? The difference is due to loading effect. I think most of you are aware of it. Without being sold by B actually, see, A thought that he has transferred to B. A has thought that he has, of whatever goods that has been transferred by him to B, he has assumed as goods have been sold. That is why he was able to ascertain the profit. But in reality, out of 10 units that has been dispatched to A, B has sold only how many units? 8. That means 2 units without being sold is being treated by A as profit has been generated. As profit has been generated. Therefore, the 2 units, on 2 units without being sold by B, A is treating as profit has been generated. So, he is treating this as a sale. But without being sold, if you treat as a profit, it is what is called as unrealized profit. What is that is being called as unrealized profit? So what is unrealized profit, sir? Unrealized profit is on is on, please remember, unraised profit is on closing stock of, unrealized profit is on closing stock of B. So B closing stock is been overvalued. You can see what is overvalued, sir, 12 rupees. What is actual cost price? 10. Because since he is getting at 12 rupees for department B, he feels that whatever he is getting, he is feeling that as a cost price. But in fact, this 12 rupees is not cost price, actual cost price. This is inflated price. Department B doesn't know. So he is thinking that cost price. So he has taken 12 rupees. But actually, if you look at the business as a whole, what is the cost price? Business knows. AB Enterprise as a whole knows the cost price is 10 rupees. It has been sent at an inflated price. So therefore, this has been overvalued. No? Closing stock is overvalued. You get more profit. That is the reason why you got a profit of 60. But when you prepare accounts, the accounts you have to prepare like this only. Whatever we have done, this is correct. Department A wise trading account is correct. Department B wise trading account is correct. But to remove the loading effect, like you have done, you learn in consignment account, unsold stock, loading effect on unsold stock is the difference between invoice price and the cost price. You remember the entry you learned, consignment account data to stock reserve, you used to write, no? Same thing, combined P&L account or general P&L account data to stock reserve, right? Stock reserve. Stock reserve is the loading on unsold stock. It is being called as unrealized profit on closing stock of B. How many units, sir? 2 units. What is the price, sir? Inflated price extra, 2 rupees. 2 into 2, 4. Now, come on. 36 rupees minus 4 rupees, you are getting how much? 32. So, what is the correct profit? This is correct result. Clear to all of you? This is correct result. This is how you should prepare. You should able to understand the meaning of unrealized profit. Let me put it in this way. If there is any unrealized profit appearing in the books of transferee department, I am using the one more word. Here, department A is transferring the goods. No, department A is called as transferer. Department B is called as transferee. Department A is called as transferee. Department B is called as transferee. Clear to all of you? So now, what is unreal profit? If there is any unrealized profit appearing in the books of transferee, that is receiving department, who is receiving B on goods belongs to transfer department sender, it is to be eliminated by passing the following entry. Entry is general P&L account data to stock reserve. Okay, so I think this is the reason why we are going for unrealized profit. Come on, conclusion, unrealized profit will be there on the closing stock of receiving department, that too when the goods have been transferred by one department to another department at a price which is more than cost price. So here I wish to give you few points on this. is if there is any unrealized profit, that is on the closing stock of receiving department, when goods are sent by transfer at a price which is more than cost price, is to be eliminated so as to get actual profit of business concern as a whole. Actual profit of a business business concern as a whole. I repeat once again, there is any unrealized profit, that is on the closing stock of receiving department, when goods are sent by transfer at a price which is more than cost price, is to be eliminated so as to get an actual profit of a business concern as a whole. Why? The reason I have already told you. This is clear to all of you, because for receiving department he is assuming the cost price is 12, so unsold stock is writing at cost price. Actually, the reason is why we need to use the term unrealized profit. Today's discussion is very, 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 very important for branch accounts. That is why department accounts, after completion of department's account, immediate chapter to be discussed for your understanding is branch account. Not branch, then department. Some people say, but I think the reason is why we should start with department will be understanding. The same department A, B will become A branch to B branch. Logic is same. So that is why understanding of the department account is very, very important. What is the meaning of unrealized profit? Unrealized profit question arises because transfer department at the time of transferring the goods, assuming that the good that has been transferred by him to other department, he is assuming that all those goods have been sold. But in fact, those goods received by B, in the above example, 10 cases or 10 units, 10 items that has been dispatched, B department is selling only 8. That means 2 items has not been sold. But when you are preparing the gross profit combined result of A and B together as a business as a whole, 10 units have been purchased, 8 units have been sold. So, but the sending department A is assuming the goods have been sold, all goods have been sold. In reality, it is not the case. That is why, to have a clarity, I have taken simple example. Cost price is 10 rupees, selling price is 14 rupees. A is transferring to B at 12, but actually, ultimately, the goods transferred by A has been sold by B at 14 rupees. So, 10 rupees item has been sold at 4 rupees. 4 rupees is the profit. 8 into 4, 32. But if you look at it, the overall profit, how much you are getting? 36. The reason is that here, A has assumed all the goods have been sold by him. So, you got a profit of 20. In fact, this actually, you can get correct profit if you take 8 into 12, 96. If you take 8 into 12, then you will be having 2 as a unsold stock. 2 into 10, 20, 96 plus 20. You'll be getting 116 minus 20, 100. You'll be getting 16 rupees profit. If we get 16 rupees profit plus 16 will become how much? 32. Got it? See, if you write, instead of writing all 10 have been sold, if you write 8, the answer will be right. But since he has treated as all 10 have been sold, that is we are getting a profit of 20. This is what is called as unrealized profit. When you will be knowing unrealized profit? How you will be knowing, sir? The closing stock of transferee department is consisting of goods that has been transferred by transferer. Is unsold, the question of unrealized profit arises. If there is any unrealized profit, that is on the closing stock of receiving department, when goods are sent by transfer at a cost price, which is more than cost price, is to be eliminated so as to get the actual profit. So, hint is that here, giving once again hint to you, how to know that there is unrealized profit. Sometimes what happened, you know, Department B, say for example, Department B closing stock may consisting of come on, where you will be having, where you will be having unsold stock, unreal profit here. Reason is, come on, tell me. Purchase goods by B, goods purchased by B, unsold. Only you are having unreal profit when transferred goods received by B. The above example, B means here, receiving department, unsold. That which is cost at profit, then the question of unrealized profit arises. All of you, when the question of unrealized profit arises, transferred goods received by B, unsold. That is transferee goods unsold, consisting of transferred goods, which is valued at cost plus profit, then the question of unrealized profit arises. Here, there is no unreal profit. Only when transferred goods are consisting at a price which is more than cost price. If it is cost to cost, no question of unrealized profit. I have also given the entries for you. So, conclusion, the books are trans. Consisting of goods belongs to eliminated bypassing the following thing. Entry. This entry I told you, my dear friends. General P&L account, or we can say combined stock reserve account, unrealized profit on closing stock. Get all of you. Very important one. If you can understand, this topic is very easy. So, hope today's lecture is clear to you. Tomorrow onwards, we start working out the problems. Till then, bye. Thank you. God bless you. Next class.